First of all, the take-up unit consists of a fixed section of telescopic track, a moving section of telescopic track, which is attached to a 180-degree curve, and which is pushed outwards by these springs. Now, when I first look at this take-up unit, the first thing that I see is that it has been properly adjusted, in that, first of all, the shipping nuts, we call them shipping nuts, they've been taken out to the end of this threaded rod. This is important because if these nuts were here, this section of the telescopic track would not be able to extend. It would be restrained. Now I can see that we can have at least another 5 inches of travel on this side, another 5 inches of travel on the other side, meaning we have plenty of take-up available as our chain elongates over the years. This system is relatively new, I can see, because the nut that's on this side of the spring, which is used to tension the spring, you can see here we put a, if I tighten this up, this is going to cause this side, the spring, to be compressed. And that'll put more force on the 180-degree curve, causing the chain to be pulled out tighter. You can, in some instances, cause adverse effects by making this tight. Too tight means you're adding chain tension where you didn't need to, and it may cause wear on your chain, or it may even make the drive unit excessively dogged, so it'll slow down. If you look inside the slot on this, I can see that the end of the inside telescopic section is about here, meaning we have a good amount of travel overall on this section. At start, I think it's about 9 inches of travel on each side. Say, well, why do I need that much travel? Well, if you had an 800-foot long system and it's got 4 linkages per foot, you know, you've got 3,200 linkages. If they all wear 10 thou, you've got a significant amount of chain. We call it stretch, but it's really wear. And that's not good. So when do you run into problems with a take-up? Well, when this section is either reaching the end here, so if this little tab had been right at the end of this threaded rod, we'd basically be at the end of its travel. The only thing you can do at that point is collapse this take-up unit. You can do that by screwing these shipping nuts back in, making it come in. Simultaneously, you would go to the nearest track inspection section, take the cover off, pull the chain out, and then disconnect a section of chain. Let's say you take out a foot of chain, and then reconnect it, and then move those shipping nuts back out, and as you do, the system will find its new location. And from there, you would then use this nut to make this spring have the proper amount of tension on that curve. So, what's the proper amount of tension? Well, I usually go and rotate this. This one could actually be a little bit tighter, so I can turn this nut, compressing this spring a little bit more without any problem. You never want these spring coils to be touching each other, because that would mean that it's completely solid and you're putting excess pressure on the conveyor chain, causing undue wear. So something like that, I can see here by the tension on that chain that's pretty good. Now, as we said, if there are different situations whereby you would either want this to be tighter or looser, and one of them is a reversing chain. If you ever have a system where you need to reverse your chain occasionally, those springs may have to be a lot tighter, because the chain will be probably, in any case, it will be compressing this curve slightly. So you'll have to watch out for that. In most cases, as I said earlier, we want to position the take-up unit after the drive unit, as close as possible. And if there's a decline anywhere after the drive, we usually want it to take up at the bottom of the lowest point in the system. Why? Because the chain, with the loads hanging off it, has some weight to it, and it'll try to run away downhill. So it's actually going to naturally suck the chain out of the slack side of the drive unit. And then the take-up will be sitting there waiting to take it out. Okay, in the event that your take-up unit is extended all the way and you need to take out chain, I just want to show you the quick procedure for doing that. First thing we're going to do is, you can do two things here. We could either use a come-along, connect it to the crossbar, the end of this curve, and pull this in to compress these springs again. And then we're going to have slack chain in the system, which we're going to pull out at the nearest inspection section. And that may be at the drive for all intents and purposes. Or you could move these nuts, these shipping nuts in, and use them to compress the curve, compress the springs, which will move the curve in. So move that there, spin this down. That. And now it's tight, so. Okay, so now I'm going to wind this into the point where I get some slack, enough slack so I can take some chain out of the take-up unit. I may have to have a person working down there too, pulling the chain out while I'm doing this. It can take a while. The come-along method is what our guys use because it's faster. Okay, we've moved over to the drive unit and the location of the nearest inspection section. Pacline always puts an inspection section on one side or the other of the drive unit, and normally between the drive unit and the take-up, so where the chain will need to be removed. So I've already removed the locked out the unit and removed the bolts from the inspection cover. So I'll take this off. So you can see here that the winding in of the take-up unit has caused this chain to become slack. So we're able to pull this chain up and out of this inspection section. And when we do, we can now either remove a cotter pin from the joining rivet, which we have every 10 or 50 feet on this type of conveyor. But if not, we would simply take a grinder and grind the head of this rivet, so that we can then pop out this pin and take out a suitable amount of chain. It could be as little as 6 inches or as much as 12 or 18 inches, depending on how long the system is. And when we do this, we have to be careful that if our system has minimum distances between carriers, we'll have to make sure that we always leave a space bigger than that. So if our system has a minimum of 18-inch spacing between carriers, we would, and we're just taking out 6 inches, that would make a 12-inch space. We would actually have to take off a whole carrier. And this is important when carriers are going around corners where they may touch or going up and down on inclines and declines. Okay, one of the things I wanted to show you was the effect of a slack chain and what actually happens. You can see with the take-up unit wound in, this is a slack chain. And what happens is these chain pendants have basically nowhere to go. They can't be pushed closer together. When they reach a certain point, they'll go sideways. And because they have sharp edges on, they actually will scratch the track or do something else. It happens with all chains. Once you're at this point, this chain will turn sideways in the track and start scraping. It'll give a noise, and quite often you'll see metal filings on the ground, and that'll be your clue as to what's happened here. If it gets really bad, it'll push right back into the drive unit, and then you have a possibility of the caterpillar chain drive dogs jamming. So not a good situation. So it's a very easy procedure. Always look at your take-up unit first, see where the springs are, see if there's movement available. Take the chain pendant right after the drive unit and just go like this. This is excessive movement. Now we're going to have the chain tightened up again, and we'll show you what proper movement is. It should only move back and forth a small amount. Okay, so we've adjusted the take-up unit properly now, and I want to show you how much the chain pendant should move. You can see here, I'm putting a fair amount of force on it, and it's not rocking side to side very much. So that's good. And we always want it to be that way.